Good morning. All right, we're ready to go. I've been told to ask everyone to shift to the wall, I guess shift to the outside, if you have room. I've been told to do that. So there's also a green Toyota who left their lights on. Just kidding, that's a joke. All right, this week, you like that, Michael. This week, we are returning to our series First and Last, and we're coming to a close, coming to a climax of this series. If you haven't been with us on this series so far, and if you're just joining in this week, basically what we've been doing is we've been looking through major figures in the Old Testament and reading their stories in light of what Jesus has done and finding Jesus in the Old Testament. And we're doing this precisely because this is what Jesus told his disciples to do. He told his disciples to read the scriptures in this way. So far we've looked at how Adam foreshadowed Jesus, and Jesus is the second Adam, how Noah and the story of new creation foreshadowed Jesus. We looked at Abraham, the father of the faith, Isaac, who was going to be sacrificed, but he was substituted. We looked at Jacob and his vision of the stairway to heaven, Joseph and his faithfulness in the midst of hatred from his brothers. And today we land on Moses. Moses probably prefigures Christ more than anyone else in the Old Testament. He's probably the most explicitly similar to Jesus figure we have in the Old Testament. So I want to give us just an expectation on the front end. Some sermons are more practical. Some sermons you leave and you're like, okay, I learned how to do this thing. I'm going to go start doing it. Others are more about your perspective on things, how you see Jesus, your theology, how you understand things. This is going to be that type of teaching today. So you may not leave learning how to pray or learning how to do something specific like that, but hopefully you do leave with a little more motivation to read your Old Testament and to understand more about who Jesus is. So we want to begin where we begin every week in this series in Luke chapter 24. This is where we get this philosophy of interpretation. This is where Jesus taught his disciples to read the scriptures in this way. So starting in verse 44, last chapter of Luke, Jesus has died, he's resurrected, and in his resurrected body, he's teaching his disciples. He told them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Those are basically your three sections of the Old Testament in the Jewish mind. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He also said to them, "This is what is written. The Messiah, the chosen one, the anointed one, will suffer and rise from the dead the third day, and repentance for forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem." So this is like our series passage. This is basically orchestrating every sermon in this series so far. What Jesus is saying, what he's telling his disciples here, when he says the scriptures teach that the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead and repentance and forgiveness will be proclaimed to all nations, what he's doing is not quoting a specific text from the Old Testament. He's not saying that Isaiah wrote this or Jeremiah wrote this and I'm citing it here. What he's actually doing is summarizing the entire Old Testament, saying all the prophecies, all the storylines, all the characteristics of God's chosen leaders throughout the scriptures come together, and they leave you with this hope, this longing, this expectation that God is going to provide a chosen one who will reconcile the world back to God, and he's going to do this through his suffering. Somehow, his suffering is going to pave the way for all nations to come back to God. And he's saying now that his life, death, and resurrection, now that he's completed this work, he's saying that that should now influence how you go back and read these scriptures. That should influence, hey, go back and read these scriptures. And so if you're really looking for something practical today, here is the lowest hanging fruit I have for you. Jesus told his disciples to do this. Jesus, in his last days on earth, spent them teaching the scriptures to his disciples. Understanding the Hebrew scriptures and how they point to Jesus is crucial to our discipleship to Jesus. If we're going to follow Jesus and understand who Jesus claimed to be, we have to do this. The writers of the New Testament, Jesus, lots of whom were Jesus' direct disciples, wrote their letters and their gospels and anything that they wrote, and they were constantly referencing and citing the Old Testament because that is what Jesus told them. It's what Jesus taught them to do. And so today we're going to do that as disciples of Jesus. We're going to read some stuff from the Old Testament, and we're going to look at how it comes to fruition ultimately in Jesus. And today we are talking about Moses. So as Max read for us, Stephen summarized Moses' life in Acts chapter 7 in the middle of a sermon that he would be killed for just a few minutes later. And so thank you, Stephen. I don't have to patch together a bunch of Exodus. He did it for us. Thank you, Stephen. We're going to start today with Moses' words, actually. In the book of Deuteronomy, which is the fifth book of the Bible, the last book of Moses, the last book of the law, Moses, shortly before he dies, leaves Israel with a prophecy. He leaves them with a promise about a person. And this is what he says in Deuteronomy 18. So Moses is about to die. He's speaking to the generation of Israel who's about to enter the promised land. And this is what he tells them. He says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own brothers, among Israel. You must listen to him." Remember that command. You must listen to him. "This is what you requested from the Lord your God at Horeb," or Mount Sinai, "on the day of the assembly when you said, 'Let us not continue to hear the voice of the Lord our God or see this great fire any longer so that we will not die.' Then the Lord said to me," Moses, "'They have spoken well. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command him. And I will hold accountable whoever does not listen to my words that he speaks in my name.'" So what is Moses promising here? What is he prophesying? What explicitly is he saying is going to happen? Well, one, he's saying a prophet's going to come. That prophet's going to be like me. He's going to speak the words of God, and God will hold his people accountable if they do not listen to the words of this man, of this prophet who is like Moses. Something extremely interesting, at least I find it very interesting, you may yawn. Something I find very interesting is that by the time of Jesus, by the time of the New Testament, after all the Old Testament prophets have come and we have their writings today in our Old Testament, no Jewish teacher, no Jewish tradition holds that this prophecy had been fulfilled. Elijah, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Hosea, Zechariah, Daniel, all of the biggest prophets of the Old Testament who you could maybe start making a case for, no rabbi, no Jewish school of interpretation had ever come to any conclusion that this prophecy had been fulfilled. They understood this prophecy was about the Messiah, it was about the Son of David. And so what's interesting is in the first century, in the New Testament, when you read through the Gospels, you have actually a lot of circumstances where you can actually tell that people are walking around with this hope and expectation. They're wondering when the next guy comes, the next prophet comes, and the next person is starting a ministry, they're wondering, is this the guy? Is this the prophet that Moses is talking about? We actually have a couple examples of this. Let's go to John chapter 1, verse 19. This is right at the beginning. This is about John the Baptist's ministry. It says, "This was John's testimony when the Jews from Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask John, 'Who are you?' John didn't deny it, but he confessed, 'I am not the Messiah, not me.' 'What then?' they asked him. 'Are you Elijah?' 'I'm not,' he said. 'Are you the prophet?' 'No,' he answered." You can see in this that the rabbis of Jesus' day clearly did not think that this prophecy had been fulfilled. They're still awaiting this prophet. So they're wondering, "John, do you claim to be this prophet?" Later on in the Gospel of John, John chapter 6, people say this about Jesus after he performs the miracle of feeding the 5,000. Okay, in John 6, 14, this is their response. "When people saw the sign he had done with the food, they said, 'This is truly the prophet who is to come into the world.'" So in the middle of Jesus' ministry, people start to realize this is the guy. Jesus is the prophet that Moses prophesied about. So imagine you're one of these disciples. Imagine you're one of Jesus' 12 disciples. Imagine you know this. You're with Jesus every day. You know that he is the Messiah. You know that he's the one who has fulfilled this promise. How would you tell people? Would you convince people by a series of arguments? Would you try to explain this one thing that you saw one time and hope that they just get it? Well, the writers of the New Testament, specifically the writers of the Gospels, I think that they wrote their Gospels to convince people of this. I think that was one of the main elements of writing the Gospels. The Gospel writers, especially Matthew that we'll look at today, they choose to write the story of Jesus in such a way, they try to write it almost parallel to Moses. They try to write it so that you see the similarities between the two, and they don't merely claim that Jesus is the prophet. They don't just say he's the prophet, believe us, we told you so. They provide proof by telling his life story, this event, this event, this event, all sort of paralleling it to Moses. They let the facts speak for themselves. And so in a way, I do believe that this is what the Gospels actually are, which is a very specific thing. They are the story of the new Moses. They are the story of the man who fulfilled the scriptures, the law, the prophets, and the Psalms, as Jesus said in Luke 24. So don't just take my word for it. Let's read some scripture. We're going to go to three different places today in the book of Matthew. We're going to look at three main parallels of Jesus' life to the life of Moses. We ready? Focus? Got this? We're excited? Yeah. Wow, we are excited. All right, phase one, Jesus as baby Moses. Jesus as baby Moses. So if you remember from the summary that Max read for us, or if you're familiar with the story in Exodus of Moses' life, when Moses was a child, he was threatened by Pharaoh. Pharaoh was afraid of how much the Israelites were multiplying, and he sent to kill all of the newborn male infants in the place where the Israelites were living. The king was afraid of what would come out of Israel, so he tried to take things into his own hands and kill all the newborn boys. But Moses found refuge in the house of an Egyptian, Pharaoh's own daughter. And so this is the story of Moses. He is threatened as a baby, a helpless child with no agency, but through God's sovereignty and his plan, ironically, he ends up being raised in the house of Pharaoh, finding refuge in Egypt. This is Jesus's birth narrative in Matthew chapter 2, starting at verse 13. It says, after they were gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph, Mary's husband, in a dream, saying, get up, take the child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child, Jesus, to kill him. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and escaped to Egypt. He stayed there until Herod's death, so that what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet might be fulfilled. And he quotes Hosea 11 here, out of Egypt I called my son. Then Herod, when he realized that he had been outwitted by the wise men, flew into a rage. He gave orders to massacre all the boys in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old and under, in keeping with the time he had learned from the wise men. Sound familiar? Then what was spoken through Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. Quote, a voice was heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and she refused to be consoled because they are no more. So just pausing right here, Jesus is a baby. He has no agency. He's not making any physical movements or decisions that would control where he is or what he's doing. And he's already fulfilling scripture. I think that's hilarious. Verse 19, after Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt saying, get up, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel because those who intended to kill the child are dead. So he got up, took the child and his mother, and entered the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the region of Galilee. Then he went and settled in a town called Nazareth to fulfill what was spoken through the prophets, that he would be called a Nazarene. So in this section alone, Jesus fulfills three different prophecies, and he's just lying there. Moses was threatened as an infant. He found refuge, though, in Egypt. In the same way, Jesus' infancy narrative follows the exact same path. The king Herod was threatened by what was to come out of the Israelites, and he took things into his own hands and decided to try to force his way into the situation he wanted by killing all of the newborn male children. It didn't work out for Herod like it didn't work out for Pharaoh. Matthew wants us to understand at the beginning of his gospel, he wants us to understand beyond any shadow of a doubt that every single aspect of Jesus's life, not just his ministry, but even the parts where he has no direct control, no agency over where he's born, where he's raised, all those things, everything demonstrates that he is God's fulfillment of the prophecy of a new Moses. He is the new and better Moses from Deuteronomy 18. He starts off being like Moses from the moment he's born. So that's our first phase here. Phase two is Jesus is like Moses the teacher. Jesus is like Moses the teacher. This is my favorite one, so I hope you guys like this. Moses was not just the deliverer of Israel. He was not just their savior, in a sense, out of Egypt. He was not just the person who led them to the promised land. Moses was a teacher. He was a teacher of God's righteousness. Part of his role was to raise up a righteous, holy people for God that was distinct, unlike any of the other nations or pagan nations around them. When they got to the promised land, they were supposed to be trained up in the way of Moses, per se. And they were supposed to keep their covenant with God by keeping the laws that Moses commanded them through the inspiration of God. It was on Mount Sinai where Moses entered into a covenant with God on behalf of the people, and there he gave the most popular of his moral teachings, which is the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments were the foundational moral teachings of God's people. If you were commanded anything by the law of Moses, it was almost just a more specific form of one of the Ten Commandments. Okay, so where are we transitioning this to now? Well, let's look at the Ten Commandments really quick. We have, do not worship other gods, do not craft any idols, do not take the name of the Lord in vain, keep the Sabbath holy, honor your father and mother, do not murder, commit adultery, steal, lie, and do not covet your neighbor's house. Moses gave these commands to Israel on Mount Sinai because his job as Israel's leader was to establish a covenant people who were holy to God. In Leviticus 11, God says this. He says, "For I am the Lord who brought you up from the land of Egypt to be your God. So you must be holy because I'm holy." This was the mission statement of God's people. This was the path that God had set out for his people. You are to be unlike all of the others around you. You're supposed to be holy and righteous. Moses' role was to establish the people as such a holy people. And so this was Moses' role as a teacher of righteousness, and unsurprisingly, this was Jesus' role as well as the Messiah. Jesus is equivalent to Mount Sinai. Maybe I'll let you guess it for a sec. Can you think of a time where Jesus is on a mountain giving his most foundational moral teachings? You got it. I see you smiling. We're in the Sermon on the Mount here in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew explicitly wants to set this scene on a mount, even though Jesus probably preached this sermon in lots of different places, because he wants you to associate it with Moses. He wants you to realize that he is the new Moses. Jesus opens his Sermon on the Mount with a really interesting clarification. He seems to assume that the people may have a certain hang-up and maybe have a question about what Jesus is trying to do. And he starts his sermon like this. He says, "Don't think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets," the Old Testament. "I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or one stroke of a letter will pass away from the law until all things are accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commands and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does not and teaches whoever does and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven." And here's the kicker. "For I tell you, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never get into the kingdom of heaven." So like Moses, Jesus is a teacher of righteousness, calling his people to a much higher standard than the world around them for God's glory. He's calling on his disciples to take up his ways, learn from him, and in turn receive a righteousness that is that surpasses those around them, even the most religious of their day. This is a crazy thing to think about. Moses was teaching them his ways, teaching them the laws of God so that they could be more righteous than the surrounding nations. Jesus is teaching his disciples the righteousness so that they can be more righteous than even the scribes and the Pharisees around them. He's raising the bar. He's taking things to a further step, if you like. Now, this statement, if you were a first century Jew and you were in this crowd, this would probably confuse you. You would probably say, "That's impossible. How can my righteousness surpass the righteousness of our religious leaders? They know everything, right?" And so they may be thinking that Jesus is saying, "Throw out Moses, throw out the prophets, and start over." They may be thinking that's what Jesus is saying. That's why Jesus makes such a clear statement that that's not true in verse 17. "Don't think I've come to abolish the law and the prophets. I've come to fulfill them. I've come to bring obedience, full obedience to them, have come to bring them to completion. The law of Moses, and here's the thought I want us to have about that. The law of Moses was a stepping stone to the way of Jesus. The law of Moses was a stepping stone to the way of Jesus. The way of Jesus does not dismiss the law of Moses, doesn't throw it away, say, don't even worry about commandments like don't murder, don't steal, don't commit adultery. He actually goes deeper. He makes it almost harder. But he's raising the bar, creating a people with a righteousness higher than that of the people Moses was responsible for leading. So let's dig into this sermon. Let's look at some examples. We're going to look at his first three moral teachings in the Sermon on the Mount and look at actually the way that he teaches this. He engages with the law of Moses. So in Matthew 5:21, here's his first moral teaching. He says, "You have heard that it was said to our ancestors, do not murder, and whoever murders will be subject to judgment." He's quoting the Ten Commandments. That's Moses. "You've heard that said to our ancestors. But I tell you, everyone who is angry with his brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Whoever insults his brother or sister will be subject to the court. Whoever says, you fool, will be subject to hellfire." He says, Moses required this. Moses taught you this. But I tell you something even deeper. I'm commanding you something even deeper. He sounds a lot like Moses. The next moral teaching about adultery in verse 27, he says, "You have heard that it was said, do not commit adultery." It's another one of the Ten Commandments. He's interacting with Moses. "But I tell you, everyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart." His heart. What's Jesus doing? Jesus is raising the bar of righteousness. He's inaugurating a people with a new level of righteousness. He's taking things forward a step. He's fulfilling the law and the prophets. Verse 31, his third moral teaching, he says, "It was also said, whoever divorces his wife must give her a written notice of divorce." That's a divorce law from Deuteronomy 24. He says, "But I tell you, everyone who divorces his wife, except in the case of sexual immorality, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery." Jesus would go on to explain more about that one in Matthew 19. His disciples would go on to say, well, maybe we just shouldn't get married then. That just sounds so hard. Jesus is really raising the bar here. So think about this question. Compare Jesus and compare Moses. Which is more righteous? A community who doesn't murder or a community who does not hate? A community that's not driven by their anger. Which is more righteous, a community where adultery doesn't take place or a community where lust doesn't take place? Which is more righteous, a community where divorce is permitted when you feel like it, or a community where divorce is a rarity because marriage is viewed correctly as a lifelong commitment? The answer is the second one. The answers are pretty obvious, and the righteous community, the more righteous community, is the one that Jesus is creating, the one that you and I are a part of today. This is the fulfillment of the prophecy in Deuteronomy 18, that the prophet will speak the words of God and God will hold accountable those who do not listen to him. This is exactly what is happening here. Our third phase today also takes place on a mountain. And this is Jesus as Moses the mediator. So Moses, another role of Moses was that he was the mediator between God and the people. He was the go-between between God and Israel. If Israel needed to speak to God, Moses would take the message up on the mountain. If God wanted to speak to the people, he brought the message down to the people. In Matthew 17, we get an eerily similar story with Jesus and his disciples. Starting in verse 1, we read this about the story of the Transfiguration. It says, "After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and his brother John," his three closest disciples, "and he led them up on a high mountain by themselves. He was transfigured in front of him, and his face shone like the sun. His clothes became as white as the light." This is the same thing that happened when Moses went up on the mountain by himself, and God's glory shone on Moses that Moses started to radiate. It says in verse 3, "Suddenly Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, 'Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you want, I'll set up three shelters here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah.'" He didn't know what to do. He was freaking out. Verse 5, while he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." Listen to him. It's the exact thing that was commanded in the prophecy in Deuteronomy 18. When the disciples heard this, they did exactly what Moses did on Mount Sinai. They fell face down and they were terrified. They worshiped him. Jesus came up, touched them, and said, "Get up. Don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, "Don't tell anyone about the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead." So the disciples asked him, "Why then do the scribes say that Elijah must come first? Elijah is coming and will restore everything," he replied, "but I tell you, Elijah has already come," and they did not recognize him. On the contrary, they did whatever they pleased to him. In the same way, the Son of Man is going to suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he had spoken to them about John the Baptist. So there's another outstanding prophecy that Elijah, or an Elijah type, will return. Like Elijah from the Old Testament, Jesus is saying here that John the Baptist was that man. And they did whatever they wanted to John. They ridiculed him, they mocked him, they put him in jail, and they ultimately killed him. Moses had a pretty similar life story. Moses came to Israel. He left the comforts of the house of Pharaoh, and he came to Israel. And Stephen says this in Acts chapter 7. And he tried to start delivering them. He saw someone beating up an Israelite, and he goes and strikes down the Egyptian. Stephen's recap says, Moses assumed that they would realize that he was bringing deliverance to them, but they didn't understand it. They didn't understand the salvation that Moses was bringing to them. Jesus says his life is going to be the exact same. I'm here to suffer on behalf of the people, and they're not going to understand it. I'm not going to be received in the way that I should be, and they're going to kill me. Jesus is like the new Moses up until the point of his death. And so Moses meets the Lord on the mountain, Mount Sinai, in the same way in the Transfiguration, Jesus does something similar, except he's not meeting the Lord on the mountain per se. Jesus is revealing himself as the Lord on the mountain. Moses interacted with God. He brought messages between God to the people of Israel. Jesus is between God and the people. He's the intersection of God and man. And now, we've talked a lot about Moses specifically, but this story actually helps us to tie a bow on this whole series, actually. So Jesus is saying frequently that he is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets, right? He's the fulfillment of the entire scriptures. Well, in the law of Moses, there's a law. If you're going to make a strong claim about anything, like such as like so-and-so committed this crime against me, so I saw so-and-so commit this thing against this person. If you're going to make a really bold claim, it was in the law of Moses that you needed two witnesses. You needed two valid eyewitnesses to affirm and to testify what you're claiming. Okay? And actually what's going on this mountain is something even deeper than Jesus just being the new Moses. He has Elijah and Moses testifying to him, affirming this claim. Moses is the human representative of the law. He wrote the law. Elijah is considered the most significant prophet of the Old Testament. He had the most powerful ministry. And so what you have standing next to Jesus on this mountain is the physical embodiment of the law and the prophets. Moses and Elijah testifying that Jesus is who he says he is. He's exactly who he said he is. He is the prophet who was to come. He is this new Moses. But Jesus says there's some bad news. Just like Moses, the people are not going to realize it the first coming, the first time around. They're not going to realize the salvation and the deliverance that I've come to bring them. But we know as believers that the story does not end there. Last week, David preached on the story of Joseph. And Joseph was a great guy. You read through Joseph's story and you're like, wow, he did a lot of things right. He was faithful during persecution, during violence, during hatred against him. He was faithful. And he was God. He was used by God in mighty ways. Really, the only bad part, the only sad part about that story is that Joseph dies. When you get to the end of that story, you're not looking back saying, man, I wish Joseph did a bunch of things differently. You're kind of wishing, man, I wish Joseph didn't have to die. Or at least that he wouldn't stay dead. Something like that. Jesus' story doesn't end like that. It doesn't end how Joseph end. It doesn't end how Moses' story ends. In John chapter 1, starting verse 10, John lays out what exactly Jesus did for us by going through this death. It says that he was in the world, Jesus, and the world was created through him. Yet the world did not recognize him. He came to his own, the Jews, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of natural descent or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. Just like Moses left the comforts of the house of Pharaoh to go fulfill his duty to deliver his own people, Jesus did the exact same thing. He left the throne of heaven to deliver his own, to save his own. But shortly after, Jesus would be betrayed by his own, be betrayed by one of his best friends. And like Moses and the prophets before him, he would be mocked and ridiculed. And like many of the prophets before him, he would be killed for what he said. He would be killed instead of being listened to, just as the prophecy told his people to do. He'd be killed instead of being listened to. But Jesus did this. This is the good news of the gospel. Jesus did this so that in John's words, you and I could receive him and be called children of God. Because we know that the story of Jesus's death doesn't end there, it ends in life. It ends in the resurrection. And that's why every single week as Christians, we celebrate the fact that Jesus died. We celebrate the fact that his story includes death because we celebrate the fact that his story doesn't end in death. And that the moment Jesus died on that cross was actually the moment that you and I became alive.